Sabine. Yeah,
thank you very much for the introduction and thanks to the organizers for inviting me. And maybe I can pick up the topic differences between adult and pediatric heart failure. We work on heart failure and TAE cardiomyopathies, specifically pediatric cardiomyopathies as an example for heart failure. And so I want to actually present you data that we have generated in Berlin throughout the last years and start right away. Norbert already mentioned that heart failure is still the most common cause of mortality and morbidity. And we work on the genetic forms, the familial cardiomyopathies. So it's actually a rare disease. There's a lack of prospective population-based data, and there's one landmark paper from 2003 by Stephen Lipschultz that showed that DCM and HCM, what we all know, are the most common cardiomyopathies. And the age of onset is actually very early in children. 41% in this study, the onset was before the first year, within the first year of life. And if we take a look, what is the cause of HCM and DCM? We find HCM in dark blue to be more frequent in metabolic cardiomyopathy and malformation syndromes. And in DCM is more common in neuromuscular disorders and, of course, myocarditis. And then we have the familial cardiomyopathies or also idiopathic cardiomyopathies. And that's going to be the focus of my talk. And we actually focus on these primary, so-called primary cardiomyopathies. So we know that cardiomyopathies are genetically determined. We have worked on many genes in the meantime, and most of the genes that cause HCM are sarcomeric genes, and for DCM it's much more heterogeneous, it's sarcomeric genes, but also cytoskeletal genes or mutations in mitochondrial genes. FVC is some kind of specific, it's more a disease of the desmosome. And left ventricular non-compaction, again, is mostly a disease of the sarcomere, and there some specific genes have also been discovered. So when we look at children or adults, many of these genes or mutations in these genes are found in children as well as in adults. And I would don't give you an overview of all the literature, but I just go straight into our own data here. And on our setup, how we should try to approach the problem to look at genotypes and phenotypes. So this is our integrated analysis approach here in Berlin. Of course, first of all, we have to assess the patients and their families and in-depth cardiac phenotyping, second step, and we do the genetic analysis, and the variant interpretation is also crucial. And then we hopefully can go back to the patients and their families and give them advice. So I want to present you our results on the RICARDO study, which was carried out during the last 5 years, and which we were we are very happy that we have published this in the Journal of the American Heart Association just very recently. RICARDO stands for Risk Stratification in Children and Adolescents with Primary Cardiomyopathy. So why do we do this? Like I said, we need to characterize these pediatric patients for risk evaluation to enable family counseling and, of course, also to develop individual diagnostic and new therapy regimes. So this was carried out at the German Heart Center Berlin, and patients came from the Charité, of course, as well. So this is our study protocol. All the index patients were younger than 18 years, and we included all first-degree family members, the parents and siblings, and also all siblings under 18 years of age. And on the right side, you find here the protocol. And we did genetic testing in all the index patients with next-generation sequencing. And just want to point out, all first-degree relatives got cardiac magnetic resonance imaging, and for children it was only possible, of course, when they did not need sedation. So the phenotyping was carried out according to standardized criteria for cardiomyopathy, and what we were really looking for is patients who are at risk, family members who are at risk. So we looked clinically, first of all, for suspected cardiomyopathy in family members, and here are the criteria which we picked out to look at borderline cases, and this was really specifically defined in function, in morphology, and also in septal thickness, criteria for the different subtypes of cardiomyopathy. So with the family screening, we actually got 60 index patients and 124 family members. And then we created three different groups. Group one was these families with at least one more affected family member apart from the index patient. Group two included family members who had suspected cardiomyopathy, and group three, there was only the index patient and no other affected family member, not even suspected. For the genetic analysis here, we found a genetic variant of interest in 45 of these 60 families. And in 12 families, we could not detect even one genetic variant. I come to the genetic analysis a bit later. And interestingly here, in the families with probably familial cardiomyopathy, in every one of them, we find a genetic variant of interest. So identification of at-risk relatives. These are CMRs from typical cardiomyopathies here. Interestingly, the family members, most of them had exactly the same subtype of cardiomyopathy as the index patient. And in these 30 family members with suspected cardiomyopathy, two-thirds of them had hypertrophication. So this we actually identified as obviously a risk factor in the family to have cardiomyopathy or to develop cardiomyopathy. These are the baseline clinical characteristics. Just want to mention that the median age was 7.8 years. Heart failure was more prominent in DCM and RCM patients, of course. And we were very surprised that we found a little arrhythmias in these patients, even in the HCM patients. Some of them had, for primary prevention, they had an ICD implanted, but no appropriate shocks. LGE was present in four of the eight HCM patients. And for MACE, major adverse events, I come to the next slide here. We see with the combined endpoint is mechanical circulatory support, heart transplantation, and death. And with this, we see that the combined endpoint is reached in one-third of patients here after median follow-up time of 3 years. Risk factors we could identify was lower body surface area, increased NT-proBNP, LV dysfunction or dilatation. And interestingly, there was age at diagnosis or gender had no significant impact on the combined endpoint. For the different subtypes, like I mentioned before, DCM and RCM have the worst prognosis, and for the genetic analysis here, obviously there's an increased risk for adverse events if the individual carries more than one genetic variant. This is statistically significant, whereas the difference between sporadic cardiomyopathy and genetic cardiomyopathy does not reach statistical significance. This is just to point out some of the pedigrees. We had most of the variants we found were heterozygous, and there were missense variants, and in 38 of these index patients we found 38% we found likely pathogenic or pathogenic variants. Here is, for instance, adenovo variants we find in 10% of index patients we find de novo variants. There's a combination of variants that, from what we see. So it's not only a monogenic disease, and this brings me to the genetic analysis that I want to explain a bit more in detail. We had a panel analysis here. 174 genes were on this panel, and we filtered with a minor allele frequency and did the bioinformatic analysis in 89 known cardiomyopathy genes. And the variants we found were confirmed with Sanger sequencing. And then, of course, we carried on and validated them according to the guidelines of the American College of Medical Genetics. So these are the from the genetic analysis, which was actually done in 80 patients. These are the subtypes at age of diagnosis. And remarkably, we see a similar subtype distribution, no matter if the index patient is younger than 1 year of age or has received heart transplantation during our study. So, like in the Lipschultz paper, of course, we have primary cardiomyopathies, but we have a really large a percentage of patients here that are within the first year of their life at time of diagnosis. So this is also kind of interesting data on the distribution, age, and also subtypes here. The distribution of genetic variants in cardiomyopathy genes, what we found is that myosin heavy chain, myosin binding protein C, and troponin I are the most frequent genetic variants we find. And actually, MYH7 myosin heavy chain is the most frequent gene that carries mutations in all of the subtypes, except for restrictive cardiomyopathy, where titin is a frequent disease gene, which might fit to the function of titin in the heart. We grouped the genes according to their molecular functional into molecular functional groups, and we see that independent of a subtype of cardiomyopathy, sarcomere gene mutations are the most frequently found. And also, again here, in patients within the first year of life and in the overall cohort, sarcomere genes are most frequently found. So again, here's no difference. So this is just to point out again, young, older, are there differences? And I take the myosin heavy chain here as an example. We found 12 variants in MYH7, and 9 of them were already published, 3 were novel and not reported in the literature. And we looked into the literature if these variants have been reported in children and adults or in either one of them. And in 6 of these 12, actually, we found accurate data in publications that they are found in children and in adults. So obviously, this a variant in myosin heavy chain to have one heterozygous variant is not an explanation for early onset of disease, as these variants are found independent of age. Just to point out the work on troponin I, we've had 2 homozygous troponin I index patients, and they were consanguineous and are consanguineous parents. And we found within the homozygous troponin I cases, we found complete loss of the protein in eye protein here in Western blot and relative expression, which also pointed out these were really severely ill patients, needed transplantation in the first year of life. So this is an interesting example of like troponin I now is really on our list. If we see this, this points to really severe cases, as also the heterozygous variants here, all in exon 8, had really severe causes of disease. So I come to the end. I told you about the genetics. In 38% of the patients, we find likely pathogenic or pathogenic variants. Variants are most frequent in myosin heavy chain, myosin binding protein C, and troponin I. And troponin I variants cause severe cardiomyopathy. So this was just accepted in clinical genetics. And for the RICADA study, I hope I could show you that we identified parameters for adverse outcome. And we see that DCM and RCM carry the worst, patients carry the worst prognosis. And we picked out hypertrabeculated myocardium as a very frequent abnormality in family members with cardiomyopathies. And for the clinical implications, I think it's quite clear. We need a systematic phenotype and genotype characterization, which will guide us to give better prognosis to the patients. And for this, of course, we need multi-center studies. And with this, I come to the end, and I'm happy to take questions. Thank you very much.